Good morning. I like how the sun came brightly into as she was finishing up the prelude. Nice job, Nancy. Welcome. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here at First Congregational Church. We are glad to be here today celebrating worship together. First of all, I want to thank Cindy, even though she's not in here to hear it, for getting things cooled down. I mean, it's really very pleasant in here, and we are leaving the fans on. She even brought in those electric things in case the flames went out. So she's just thought of everything. A big, huge thank you to Chris and Tim O'Neill for hosting our annual church picnic last Sunday. We appreciate all their efforts. Great food and home hospitality. It was really lovely, and we had a nice turnout. We have an immediate need for a financial secretary. This is a volunteer position that is responsible for handling and counting and reconciling the Sunday offering, data entry of received donations, and bank deposits. This position reports to our church administrator and may work with our bookkeeper to clarify above information as needed. If you are interested in serving in this capacity, please contact the church office. The mission committee is hosting a night at the Rumble Ponies on Friday, August 2nd. Game time starts at 7:05 p.m., followed by the Miller Auto Team Fireworks. Tickets will be approximately $12.50 per person, depending on the number of people that participate. Ticket money is due to the office by Wednesday, July 17th. No exceptions. If you wish to participate, please sign up at the Welcome Center out there and by contacting the church office. If you have any questions or would like more information, please see Mary Warren, but not today because she's not here right now. She will be, though. Thank you, Judy. We are currently accepting applications for our academic awards. If you know someone who could benefit from one, please have them complete an application and return it to the church office by 3 p.m. on July 25th. John has been on vacation all this week, and I hope he's had a lovely time staying home. And Cindy will be on vacation this coming week, the 1st to the 6th. If you need anything while she is out, please contact the church office. Thursday, July 4th is Independence Day. Please note our offices will be closed that day. All right, anybody have anything else? Oh, yes, Chris has something else that I'm doing it for. She does need liturgists for July. She's got the first Sunday covered and the last Sunday covered, and she needs the 14th and the 21st. So anyway, there's no new sign-up sheet for liturgists in the parlor right now, but I put it on Carrie's desk, so that she'll have a sign-up sheet. So if you have any interest in doing this, it's a pretty low-key commitment. It's a one-shot deal. So please, if you've never done it, it's not hard. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to do it. Well, maybe. Who knows? Okay. With that, let us move on to our call to worship found in your bulletin. We pray to God and wait for what God will say and do. We cry to God for help because we've hit rock bottom. If God kept records on wrongdoing, who would stand a chance? And that is why God is worshipped. And by the way, before the hymn, and we want to thank Daniel Ling. It's not on the announcement. Thank Daniel Ling for covering for us this week. And it's just for a week, I promise, Jenai. So anyway, it's nice to have you back in the pulpit. All right, with that, please join us in our opening hymn.
Thank you.
now would you please join me, back on the other page, the prayer of gathering, unison. Gracious God, as we gather in your name to worship, renew a right spirit of faith within us and encourage us to take a leap of faith, knowing that you are with us and for us when we pay attention to what you are doing among us. Amen. And now we come to the time where we share the peace with each other, however you like, and we don't have a big crowd, so we should be able to get everybody. And with that, may the peace of God be with you. Please greet each other. All right, let's find our ways back to our seats, you friendly bunch. Food and friendliness and fellowship. That's First Congregational. And now would you please join me in our statement of oneness found in your bulletin. We are made in the image of God. Thus, as we grow in faith and mature in spirit, that image shall shine all the more clearly. Like Jesus, we are children of God. Thus, as our birthright, we shall live all our days surrounded by unconditional love. Humanity, the image of God, is beautiful in God's sight, part of a magnificent creation. Therefore, we are beautiful in God's eyes. The scriptures declare that the entire kingdom of God is within us. Also, we live our lives immersed in divinity. We gather to celebrate that sacred and wondrous truth. Many hurtful and unjust things happen in our world, motivated by hatred or fear. Yet also there is love in our hearts. Let us declare that love, acknowledge it is of God, and promise to grow in love day by day. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is 2 Corinthians 8, verses 7 through 15. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in love for you, our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am, by mentioning the eagerness of others, testing the genuineness of your love. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might be rich. And in this matter I am giving my opinion. It is beneficial for you, who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. For I do not mean that there should be relief for others and hardship for you, but it is a question of equality between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may also supply your need, in order that there may be equality. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. The word of God.
If you are able, you are welcome to stand for the gospel reading. Mark 5, 21 to 43. When Jesus has crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet, pleaded with him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from a flow of blood for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I touch his cloak, I will be made well." Immediately, her flow of blood stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my cloak?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who has done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the synagogue leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the synagogue leader, "Do not be afraid. only believed. He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the synagogue leader's house, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kumi," which in Arabic means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl stood up and began to walk about. She was 12 years old. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The word of God. Today's reading talk about faith. How do you get faith? If you look at the scriptures, it says faith comes by hearing the word of God. We are saved by grace through faith. So faith is actually a gift from God. It is not our own doing. We are saved by grace. Faith is a gift that God gives to us, and faith is what today's scripture reading is about. Jairus, the ruler of the synagogue, and you know, as a ruler, the scribes and Pharisees, they were not for Jesus. Some of them were against Jesus, always criticizing. But in her desperate need, because her daughter was at the point of dying, so in spite of what others would think, why would you go to Jesus? You are against Jesus. She went out of faith, saying to Jesus, "Come, touch my daughter, and she will be healed." She used her faith. She exercised her faith. Faith is like a muscle. If you don't use it, you may lose it. And the more you use it, the more you have it. So if you look at faith, why is it that we are not growing in our faith? You know, the disciples asked Jesus two questions. One is, teach us how to pray. The other one is, increase our faith. Increase our faith. Why is it that we do not exercise our faith? Because many times we are afraid. Many times we are too proud to admit that we need faith. Jesus, in these two healings, show us the importance of exercising your faith. Jesus says, "Do not be afraid, only believe." If you believe, all things are possible. In fact, the scripture says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. So we want to talk about taking a leap of faith. What does it mean? If you look at the scripture examples of faith. Look at the book of Hebrews. Look at Abraham. When God called Abraham, Abraham didn't even know where, but God said, come, I will make you a father of many nations. And it was not until many, 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 many years later that they have a child. So faith also shows us that if we obey God, it doesn't mean it will happen for us whatever we want. It may take time. God will test us. A leap of faith is to say, I don't know what the outcome will be. I don't know if you've ever taken a leap of faith. I can say that in my journey of faith, that some of you remember April the 3rd, 2009. Any of you remember the date? Right here at the Civic Association, there was a shooting. I was a pastor at Shenango Bridge United Methodist Church. And because the people who were shot, they were immigrants, and some of them were Chinese. So the lady who belongs to my church worked with the police department, called me on the phone, Pastor, can you come down to the building? Can you help us? We need translators. Families and friends, they are looking for answers. When I got the call, there was fear within me. They said the gunman is still in the room. Whenever I'm faced with such situation, I always look at my wife. I said, should I go? And she has a way of smiling and said, you decide. So I started to reason with my faith. I said, I could die if I go. I also tried to rationalize, I don't have to go. I'm not their pastor. I have my own congregation. But then there are families who are anxiously waiting. They don't speak much English. And I happen to speak Chinese. And I could translate and help them through this anxious moment. So what shall I do? All of a sudden, in my anxiety and fear, the words came. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear what? No evil. So I said to my wife, I'm going. It gave me a leap of faith. You see what the Word of God can do for you? It's almost like many times, you know, when we are asked to transfer to another church, to take a new congregation, I often had to pray about it, and many times the word will come. The hymns, trust and obey. What he says, we will do. Where he sends, we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. I don't know if you have ever taken a leap of faith. For this ruler of the synagogue, it was a leap of faith to go to Jesus in spite of what other people are talking about Jesus. He said, please, my daughter is dying. Come and lay your hands. Then for the other woman who had been suffering hemorrhage for 12 years, spent her life saving. She was desperate, but she had faith that if only I could touch the clothing, of Jesus, I'll be healed. And because of so many people pressing against Jesus, she thought she could sneak in and just touch Jesus. But power was experienced by her. She was healed. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" She must be trembling. And she said, I did. And Jesus said to her, "Daughter," that is a very wonderful way of addressing a woman, "daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." So we find here the leap of faith has so many implications. Noah was called by God. People were so bad that God regretted creating human beings. So God said, "Noah, go build me a boat on the mountaintop." And you know, if you don't have faith, you will be a laughing stock. And true enough, a lot of people laugh at him, this crazy old man building a boat. But when it started to rain, 40 days, 40 nights, when the doors of the ark was closed, people was knocking, screaming, "Open, please, help." Noah took a leap of faith, trusting God. Another example in my life is February 26, Ash Wednesday, 2020. Any of you remember the date? February 26, Ash Wednesday, 2020. By the grace of God, I took a leap of faith, signed a 6-month contract to be the interim pastor of FCC. Now, never in my wildest dream, a United Methodist pastor becoming. So they say 6 months. Okay, I can take 6 months. So we signed a 6-month contract. And after 6 months, it went to 1 year. It went to 1.5 years. 2 years. 2.5 years. Thank God for the search committee. They were very patient. I think Chris and the others who were in the committee worked very, very hard. It wasn't an easy committee. Not everybody could see eye to eye, but thank God it's all over. Another day. I don't know why God, in God's wisdom, helped me stay from 6 months to 2.5 years. There's a reason. A woman from Owego, one Sunday morning, God said, "Go to church." And she said, "Where?" "Just go." And guess where she drove? From Owego to FCC parking lot. And normally during COVID time, our front door is locked. She arrived exactly at 10 o'clock. Tom Bucker was out there ringing the bell. So she slipped through the door. Otherwise, she may not even enter. During worship, she was distressed. After worship, our wonderful Julianne Johnson noticed her very distressed. She says, "May I give you a hug?" And as soon as Julianne hugged her, tears just came flowing down. Why am I telling this story? Because if you take a leap of faith, if God speaks to you, there's no way you can deny or even stop it. How do we know Abraham was called? How do we know Noah was called? How do we know all the people? Because they gave their testimony. June 19, 2022, right here at this baptismal, this young woman, a child of God, was baptized. She said, "Thank God you stayed more than 6 months. Otherwise, she wouldn't be baptized here." And she's sitting here right in this church right now. So you can go and ask her to give her testimony. There is joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. There is joy in heaven when we take a leap of faith and say, "God, what have I done to deserve your love? You are so amazing. You love me unconditionally." There's a book called Holy Chaos. I don't know if you have seen it. It's in the library. And it's by Amanda Henderson. It talks about how to practice making connections during this divisive time. Do we all agree that our country is divided? Anybody disagree? We are so divided, it hurts. But there is such a thing as holy chaos. So relax. Take this book. If you haven't checked it out, it's in the library. It will be there. Check it out and read it, or form a committee and say, how do we make connections with a divided society? Politically, you know, family-wise, among friends. We're so divided. It's sad. We need faith. We need to know that if we can build our trust in the God who loves us unconditionally, then we can reap what we sow. Faith is like a seed. You know, I'm a farmer by heart. I have a garden. I love to plant, and you reap what you sow. If you plant goodness, you will reap goodness. If you plant kindness, you will reap kindness. If you sow wickedness, you will reap wickedness. So the sower will reap what you and I will sow. Trusting that God will bring the harvest. No matter what, life is a gift to us. You can lose money and you will lose quite a few. You can lose friends and you will lose more of life. But if you lose your faith, you have lost everything. So keep the faith, because without faith, it is impossible to please God. I was reading the newsletter, and your pastor made some suggestion during summertime, some of you to take the leap of faith and write a poem and come to church and read it. Some of you should sing a song and share your faith. So I'm going to take a leap of faith and share a song as my closing. Children are a gift to me. I have a 9-year-old granddaughter. She accompany us. Seven of us went back to Singapore and Malaysia for 3 weeks. Imagine seven of us. It used to be that you had to take Binghamton to Detroit and Tokyo and then Singapore. It takes 2 days. Today, we can fly from Newark, non-stop, Singapore Airlines, 19 hours. I don't know how they do it, where they get so much fuel. You need four pilots to fly the plane, non-stop, you know, 19 hours, 9,356 miles. And we always sing together, Jesus said, let the children come to me, of such is the kingdom of heaven. So this is one of her favorite songs, and children listen differently. I ask her, I say, what is God's name? You know what she said? Andy. I said, Andy, how did you get that? Andy walks with me, Andy talks with me, Andy tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarried there, none other has ever known. 1, 2, 3, Jesus loves me. 1, 2, Jesus loves you. 2, 3, 4, he loves you more than you ever be loved before. 5, 6, 7, we're going to heaven. 8, 9 is truly divine. 8, 9, 10 is time to end. But I think I've seen it again. You can sing it all the way home. Our hymn, We Walk by Faith.
My sight, no precious words. Hi, I think many of you know I've been going through trials or, what's a better word for it? I can't think. I've had trouble with evil. And yesterday I was sitting around and I just started saying, I love myself, I love myself, I love myself. And that helped like more than anything else I've tried thus far. I was surprised actually that would do it, you know, that just saying that would bring some healing into my life. So I wanted to share that joy.
Good morning. I just wanted to give an update on my grandson, AJ. He's still in the ICU at Wilson, and he's off the vent, but he has a trach, and the physical therapy people are trying to strengthen his diaphragm so he can breathe independently without assistance. So baby steps all the time, and his emotions are up and down as the sedation goes away. He's able to recall some of what he's experienced thus far. So it's an emotional ride. We'll be here probably, I'm guessing, years. So, but keep him in your prayers, please. Thank you.
Hi, I'm asking for prayers for Debbie Van Dusen. She has a knee that's broken up into pieces. And just this past Thursday, she had a filter put in her vena cava, which is a network that, blood vessel, because she's susceptible to having blood clots. And they have to put this strainer in there so that Dr. Siebold is going to do the operation on the knee, but he has to be reasonably sure that she's going to be okay, not have clots go to her brain during the surgery, right? So tomorrow she gets this surgery, and I want you to pray for her. She's a member of our church, and she's had a lot of difficulties in the last few years, and this is a very important surgery. Also, another request I'm making is for someone named Bobby Fish. She actually, her actual name is Slobodanka Rajik. She worked in this church in the nursery back when we had babies. That was a long time ago. She was an immigrant. She came here. She lived in a one-room apartment. She worked in a factory. She saved her money, and she ended up going to Broome Community College and got her degree in dental hygiene. She got a job in Rome, New York, doing very well, met a nice man, got married, and his name was Fish. So she's Bobby Fish. Her nickname is Bobby, because it's hard for people to remember Slobodanka. It's hard for people to remember that. Anyway, just lately, she's had trouble with her hand, and she was reaching out to me for prayer. She says, my hands are my livelihood. I need the use of my hand. So please pray for her that her hand gets healed somehow, and that she's able to continue her work as a dental hygienist. Thank you.
Good morning. I was in a WeGo yesterday with a friend, and I think it's called Country Kitchen. It's all natural foods, very good. I had a big salad. I look out the window, and there's a car, and the car is one of those newer, looks like station wagons, but it's really cool. And you notice when people get out of the car every once in a while, well, especially if there's more than four. So then there was five, and then there was six, then there was seven, then there was eight, then there was nine. And they all came into the Country Kitchen, and I thought, you know, then there was 10, because he was watching everybody else get up. I don't know how they fit in there, but they did, and it was a long car. Well, they came in, And usually you notice people who are loud and gregarious and so on and funny or whatever, but they were all so well composed, and that includes the children and the teenagers and the family. And they all sat down quietly and they all smiled at each other, and I just thought, oh my goodness, this is just, it's such a beautiful thing to witness. And I loved their quiet composure. It's really beautiful. And they were just wonderful people. Anyways, I got to say hello to everyone. The other thing is that it's interesting that you mentioned about Jesus saying daughter to the woman who touched the hem of his robe. Because I was in, a long time ago, as a child, in a study, a Bible study, and that was one of the things that they had mentioned, that he called her daughter, and they said, is Jesus God? Is Jesus the actual God that came down to earth? So there's this whole big weeks and months of discussion on that one, but it's very interesting. And it opened up our hearts and minds to any possibilities. It was delightful. And I got to witness the adults talking and as a child, so my faith was always, went even deeper after that those discussions. The other thing is I'd like you to have prayers for my sister Linda, who has stage 4 cancer for the lungs, and she's always done everything healthy, so she doesn't smoke, and so it's been a real shock, but thank you for your prayers.
This past Tuesday was my Bob's birthday, and his two daughters and I and a grandchild and her child all went up to the cemetery and we sang happy birthday to him. But the thing that happened during this is that if I'm sure all of us have experienced a death in the family, and sometimes in this world people act oddly and they don't even understand it. It's just, there's been a wall up since Bob died between myself and these girls, and I just waited on them and prayed that, you know, we'd have again the same relationship that I thought we had. And apparently this is what did it, because there was a reconciliation, and I just feel like I'm back in the fold, and it's a very good feeling, and I appreciate it, and I thank God for it.
With leaps of faith, whenever anybody steps up to be on a committee and a board, and when they agree to be the chairperson, that's always taking a leap of faith, because none of us are, you know, paid professionals. I was the chairperson of Deacons when Daniel came to the January meeting, and I was starting to just count pulpit supply. And how many weeks? And I counted like 7, we've come through 7, and then Daniel came, and I said, well, Daniel, how many Sundays will you be available in the month? And he said, all of them. And I said, oh. And I was so amazed and relieved and impressed that with his joy in saying that, it wasn't like it was an imposition. I'm not sure how Chennai feels about it, but anyway, I will always remember that. And of course, he came and he signed that in February 2020. And then the first weekend in March, COVID joined the party. So he got us through a time when, you know, we weren't even meeting. And because of that time, we now have the video that we can send out to people who can't make it here. So that time will always be special to me, and Daniel will always be special to me because of that. I'd like prayers for all people, all the kids that are graduating. My nephew's daughter, Sydney, her party went off without a hitch. I was sorry for people yesterday who had graduation parties. But anyway, even in the rain, there's joy. So anyway, and then I just like all people
prayers for all people caught up in addiction and their families. Thanks.
Daniel, I want to say thank you for being with us today. I have so enjoyed your sermon today and the essence of your being in this sanctuary with us. Phyllis Martin would like to be remembered to you today, and she'll be watching the video later. And she wanted to thank you again. You wrote her a birthday song several years ago while you were here. And every year, she actually sings it to herself. So thank you so very much. I want to open my body language to the individuals behind me. I want to say welcome for joining us today. I hope you've been touched by this sermon. I'd like to invite you to fellowship, which is across the hall. We'll have refreshments there, and would love to get to know you. I want to say thank you to the people who I haven't seen in a while. God bless you. It means everything to me that you're here today. I'm going to end on the note of love. I love you all. And Christelle, I love you.
Amen.
I just wanted to say that the picnic was awesome. You did a wonderful job, and I enjoyed every bit of it. I'm still thinking about it every bit. Thank you very much.
Just a quick hello and blessings to everyone here, and I love you all. And my sister Maria is here with me, and I'm very happy about that.
For reminding me, just a quick, I hope you can come and visit us next Sunday. It's actually our official birthday Sunday, and it's our friendship Sunday, where we invite family and friends to join us in worship and fellowship. Thank you.
While I'm walking over here, Bob and Elizabeth Neal send their blessings to all of you and want to tell you that they miss you.
Well, it's going to be hard to get through this without tears, but I want to first of all thank God for seeing that I needed him and for sending me here. He saved my life by sending me to Pastor Ling. Ever since I started coming here, he's been teaching me about the true God. I didn't really know him. And along with his wife, they've been such good friends to me. Through them, I saw God's love. And I'm sure it took much patience. I came with a lot of baggage, but they stuck with me, and I just want to say thank you. Thank you so much, Pastor Ling, for all you've taught me, and I'm so grateful to God that he sent me here. And it's nice to see all of you as well.
Let's stand up and turn around and wave and say hi to Bob and Elizabeth. Hi, Bob and Elizabeth. We love you.
We love you. And anybody else.
And everybody else that's listening.
It's so wonderful to see Bob and in the picture waving to us, and now we're waving back. I think such contact, you know,
a touch, a hug meant a great deal. You don't have to say anything. All you need to do is hold somebody's hand. I have advice for married couple, you know. I always say to them, in your first year of marriage, always hold hands. And they say, why? I say, so you don't hit each other. If somebody is angry with you, just hold my hand. They can't hit you. As long as you hold hands and hug each other. So thank you for sharing your prayer concern and your joys. And now we go into prayers of God's people. Lord, in your mercy, let's join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hearts and minds to receive Holy Communion. Jesus, on the night that he was about to be betrayed, he took bread. He broke it. He said, "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat by faith in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. He blessed it and said, "This is the blood of the new covenant shed for the forgiveness of sin. Drink ye all of it by faith in thanksgiving." The deacons will come forward to guide us to take communion. The table belongs to the Lord, so all who has faith, please come. The white cups are wine, and then the red is wine. So come by faith and remember what Jesus has done for you. Thank you. Let us pray. Lord, you came to us in your Son Jesus Christ to show us how much you love us. Bless us as we receive communion, that we too may be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is "He Touched Me." The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the comfort, guidance, and challenge of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you. Go in peace, and the peace of God go with you. And all God's people say, Amen. Amen.